was 15 years of effort and development tied up in the contents of this dark blue trailer bearing the tag Dick Johnson Racing. Over those 15 years, Queensland has seen this garage proprietor drive his way through Minis and Taranas, but over the last 5 years, concentrate on the Ford Falcon. Over that time, Johnson was always a consistent performer in Queensland, with many local titles to his credit. But he first caught the attention of Australia's motor racing public last year, when the then-current Ford Kings of Australia, like Alan Moffat, lost faith in the Falcon. It was Dick Johnson, with no factory backing or huge sponsorship, that led the Ford Challenge against Holden in the 1980 Hardy Ferrodo, Australia's most gruelling motor racing event.
Who for the first time draws the cheers of the crowd, and the Ford flags are out as they come flying up the top of the mountain on lap one of the Hardy Ferrari 1000 for 1980.
And Johnson had done his homework well. Before last year's race, a confident Dick Johnson had this to say to Sports Night.
We're going there with the assumption we're going to win. We're not sort of going there to come second or third or anything like that. And I know that this particular car will be far superior to any other Commodore there as far as power and everything goes. I'm extremely sure about that, because at Amaru it's a very, very short circuit, and we could outpace Brock, but the only reason we had to knock off the pace because the fact that the tyre wear came into the...
And Johnson proved his point in the big race. Taking the lead shortly after the start, by the 16th lap, Johnson had passed his main opposition, Peter Brock, in the Holden Commodore.
Winders, Johnson flew by there.
And Johnson with Bartlett too.
Bartlett has got a few more still to pass there. Johnson's got a break on them going up the mountain. Kevin Bartlett in second, sitting back, probably about 100 metres back behind. 10 metres to Peter Brock in third. And probably 20 metres back to Alan Grice, then John Harvey. Here they come, up towards GTX.
Up until that time, Johnson was running the race the way he'd planned it. His co-driver was the veteran John French.
Was the car going as well as what you thought it would in the early stages of the race?
Oh yes, we planned to Dick for the run the first 500 kilometres, and because I'm the senior one in the two, he was going to open up a gap for me to coast along. But no, he was going to break him up early and do 22s, and which he did. They ran with him for a few laps, but then he was going away from them. And then he was going to case back to about 24s, laps of 24s, and this was what he was doing when the unfortunate incident happened.
Missed the cool of motor racing, but things aren't going well his way, and of course we have Kevin Bartlett with even earlier troubles with his...
Oh, we've had another bang, and is that the
Dick
race?
Johnson. Dick Johnson. Now, whether Dick has been hampered by the rescue truck here, which is out on the track, but he has gone into the fence. Dick Johnson, the leader, he's broken the left-hand front suspension. You can see, by the way, the car is leading down. Now, a rescue vehicle has been out to bring in one of the damaged vehicles. The officials are running back. I rather think that Dick came round the corner and found himself with an impossible situation. You can see them stimulating the flag marshal, saying, for heaven's sake, wave the flags.
There's what in fact happened was that Johnson slammed into a rock, which was rolled onto the track by fair means or foul. The rock which Johnson hit was the size of an overnight bag. His car, which represented a personal investment of $74,000, was totally written off, and his future in motor racing seriously in doubt. It was then that all Australia stepped in. With the tradition of helping the underdog, Dick Johnson became the folk hero of Australian motor racing, and that tag meant monetary assistance. The national appeal that was set up raised something like $80,000, more than the actual prize money for the race itself. And thousands of letters like these poured into the Johnson household in Brisbane. Where did the letters come from?
Look, they came from all over Australia, all sorts of people, little children, pensioners, families, people who aren't even interested in motor racing. We got letters from all over the place.
Were you surprised by the reaction?
Yes, very, actually. I never expected anything like this at all.
And it wasn't just Ford enthusiasts that gave their support to Johnson. Many of the letters like this one came from Holden supporters, and it says, "Let me say that I'm a Holden fan, even driver Commodore. However, we admire the effort that you undertook, and to see such a popular competitor, like yourself, suffer such hardship was unfair. Besides, we'd like to help you get back out on the track to give Brocky some competition." And this is the result of the appeal that so many Australians contributed to. At this, the car's first test, Johnson was more than happy with its performance, and after a few laps, he was already a tenth of a second under the lap record. The construction of the car started some 3 months ago with the arrival of this shell from Ford's plant in Victoria. With this as a base, the massive operation consuming thousands of man-hours was started. One of the first operations was the installation of this roll cage, made out of strong scaffolding tube. As well as protecting the driver in a case of an accident, it also plays an important role to strengthen the entire body structure of the vehicle to stop it bending and twisting under the massive pressure imposed on it in today's style of racing. A lot of parts from Johnson's wrecked Falcon from Bathurst were used in the reconstruction, but some of the main modifications to this new vehicle were made to the brakes and suspension, and because of this, the car will be a lot stiffer and should handle better, while the new ratios and fine tuning imposed on the braking system should make the car far quicker on the circuit than the old vehicle. Regulations imposed on this manufacturing class allows for safety's sake the installation of new seating if required. And in the new car, Johnson has installed what he calls the best. They're made in Germany and built to keep the driver at the wheel under the stress imposed on him during the high-speed cornering involved. As well as seating, there's the instrumentation, which is far more sophisticated than in your normal street Falcon. Apart from these features, there's special fuel tanks, aerofoils, two-way radio communications, painting, and the all-important 351 cubic inch V8, which powers what is supposed to be a conventional Ford vehicle. Let's join Johnson for a ride around Surfers Paradise Raceway in the new car.
Dick, how's the car performing at the moment? The car's actually running really well, Peter. Actually the other car never felt this good.
Do you feel it's better than your last car?
It feels quite a bit better, actually. The car seems to be a lot stiffer and a lot more predictable than the old car.
What are some of the improvements been on the car?
Well, the suspension has been changed in design a little bit. We've changed the engines a little bit, so they're giving us a little bit more power. And the brakes. And the brakes, we have spent a lot of time on the brakes, and they have worked out extremely well. Just give it a bit of a red up to 7. We'll be doing probably 240 kilometres an hour, approaching 250. Back off a little bit under the bridge, set the car up, and full power all the way through into the 200 yard braking marker, back to third gear and hard right hand corner. Rev it out to 7,000 again, into top, down the back straight, into about 150 yards, leave it in top gear. And the left hand around the sander corner. The torque, big torque of the Ford engine pulls out of there extremely well. And back into the braking area. Round Goodyear corner once again.
quite sure was some ride. Although it may look like a Ford or you or I may drive, it certainly didn't feel like it. Dick Johnson's car will lead the Ford Challenge against the Commodores this season. And don't forget, Johnson is a privateer, as opposed to Brock leading the Commodores, who have tremendous financial backing.
How much difficulty is it for Dick Johnson as a privateer competing against someone like Peter Brock with a great backup behind him?
Well, last year it was very, very difficult. He mortgaged everything to get the whole deal together. He was very fortunate in that he had a long-time sponsor in Brian Bird Ford who helped him. A friend of his, Ross Palmer from Palmer Tube Mills, assisted him, and there was other smaller sponsors that helped him a lot last year. But with the generosity after the accident, he's got enough money there, fortunately, to rebuild the car and possibly race for half a year. He has and is at the moment negotiating for other sponsors, but it's a very difficult thing for a privateer. He has to try and get sponsors, and they're not easy to come by in our economic situation.
Well, Dick, what sort of feeling does it give you when you're driving that you know all that money has been poured in by all your supporters around Australia?
Well, it gives you that little bit extra incentive to try a little bit harder, which we will be doing, because you feel as though you're obligated to do well for the people that have sort of done something for me. And I'll be trying just that little bit harder.
Did you realise that you had so many supporters?
No, I don't think I ever realised that many people were interested, but gee, it's a good feeling when you know that there is.
Apart from answering every letter sent to him, Dick Johnson will be allowing as many Australians as possible to see the car in action. For in the next few months, he will attend every meeting around Australia that he can. 9 meetings in all, ranging from Tasmania to Perth through to Brisbane, with all the capitals in between. But the race all of Australia will want to see is Dick Johnson participating in the 1981 Hardy Ferrodo 1000 at Bathurst.